to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is the podcast where we talk about screenwriting, filmmaking, and everything in between. I'm your host, Phil Galasso. Today we have an interview with Liz Flahive and Carly Mensch, creators of the Netflix show GlOW, starring Allison Brie and Betty Gilpin. GlOW follows a group of women in Los Angeles in the 1980s who reinvent themselves as the gorgeous ladies of wrestling. We discuss the way the writers approach character, the choice to take the show to Vegas in season 3, how they got their starts as writers, and more. Check it out. Liz and Carly, thank you so much for taking the time to join us. If you guys, since there's two of you and people are mostly just going to be listening to this, do you mind introducing yourselves with your name so everybody recognizes it?
All right, I'm Carly. And Liz and I think like our voices on the page will start to kind of sound similar throughout the course of this interview. Yeah. We will continue to tag ourselves.
Yeah, I'm Liz.
Okay. Well, thank you guys for taking the time to join us. I'm just going to jump right in. Season 3 of GlOW feels a little bit darker than the first two seasons. And I'm just wondering, was that sort of an intentional choice on your part, or did it kind of just come about organically? How did that sort of element seep into the season?
I don't think we started by aiming for a darker season so much as there were a lot of kind of existential things we wanted to explore, which Vegas felt like the proper setting for, ironically, and the kind of contrast between, the lights and the razzmatazz of the city and the kind of more introspective stories we were excited to dig into, that kind of matched both kind of where they were all at doing this show repetitively, the same show night after night after night, and just kind of, our reaction to Vegas, which is not everybody else's take on Vegas. I naturally went there.
Yeah, Vegas is really my idea of hell on earth. So I think that which is not true for many, many people who love it, but I feel it's really not my spot. But the idea, we did do, before we started the season, we did do a research trip there that was like legit a really nerdy research trip where we, talked to historians and went to the Showgirl Museum and, went backstage to a bunch of these performance venues at casinos. And, it was pretty fascinating because I think part of our goal with the season as well was to explore, our girls were in such a bubble during the first two seasons in LA. And I think part of this was like intersecting them with a new culture of performers, which, we got to dramatize with, the character Bobby Barnes and with Sandy.
One of the things I feel like that is a lot, in that vein of, kind of the darkness of the season, the way the sort of, obviously Debbie and Ruth are sort of main characters, but there's the individual storylines for the supporting characters felt, like they came a little bit more to the forefront this season. Like Bash's story, for instance, takes a really sad turn. Was that also something you guys were kind of looking to do, fill in those characters a bit more?
I mean, that's kind of our evolving goal with every season. I think even in season 2, we got to dig into more characters than season 1. Our aim is to kind of, by the end of the series, you've gotten to really meet and know every character. And there were certain characters who kind of lended themselves to a Vegas season a bit more than others. Bash, as you identified, is definitely someone we were excited about and just kind of, the 80s-ness of Vegas as a town that looks so permissive on the surface, but is actually like a very conservative place, a place where even Liberace himself wasn't out, was really exciting to us, especially where we left Bash and his marriage. Sheila was another person we felt would be deeply uncomfortable in a place like Vegas. So, a prime suspect to dig into more. But we're always kind of looking for opportunities to keep digging and getting to know people in the cast.
Yeah. And I think because we knew we had gone so balls to the wall with wrestling season 2, I think we, just in terms of the rhythm of our show, we went very slow season 1, teaching the characters how to wrestle. We knew we sort of couldn't come back from that once they knew how. So that storytelling was a deliberate pace. And I feel like season 2, had a very different pace in terms of just how much physicality was in that season. And I think part of the opportunity of season three in telling a story of live repeated performance was that it gave us some space outside of the ring to follow characters more fully.
When you ended season two with the the characters getting ready to go to Vegas, did you know the entire third season would be based in Vegas, or was that something that came along later?
We knew.
I think it was in our pitch to Netflix.
Oh, okay.
But don't worry. We're going there.
Can you talk a little bit more about the research trip you took? Because I'm curious, the other big element of the show, obviously, is that it's set in the 80s, and Vegas is probably, I would assume, much different. I didn't go in the 80s. I've only been, 10 years ago, so I don't know. But I would assume it's much different now than it was then.
I think it's pretty different. The things that haven't changed are, it's still a town of, you can look at it from different angles, but from kind of our perspective, it's a town of performers. But I think, in terms of our research trip, some of our highlights were probably Grant Filippo's Showgirl Museum. And he was not just kind of a character with, more Showgirl costumes than anyone has ever seen before, but also a guy with tons of stories. So we got to hear kind of, some pretty, I would say we got the 80s gossip from, who was doing too much coke and accidentally shat in the middle of their show to, who was,
removing a rib to fit into a dress. It was just like, I think, the thing you said before is that like the 80s, Vegas is a city that just like reinvents itself every number of years. When we went to the Golden Nugget, like we tried to go to places that had remnants of that time. Yeah. And still it's just, because we had a dream for a minute of like, do we go film a bit in Vegas? And there was really nothing for us there that was period appropriate. All the machines are updated. Everything is really updated. So we just were trying to sort of collect the scraps of the 80s when we went there, which was really just talking to people.
Yeah.
And I think that's,
even kind of like the role of the showgirl as a, now it's kind of become more of a symbol or an icon, but there aren't so many left. Whereas, in the 80s, that was really one of the main jobs. And for women, especially, it's a place that Liz and I kind of, we try to lean into our discomfort and the idea that the image of this whole town is a mostly naked woman wearing a, 50 pound backpack. Is intriguing to us.
Yeah. One of the most amazing things that we went to Bally's, and they, when we were thinking about shooting something there, and we went into the old showroom where they did Jubilee. And it was, it was an extraordinary space. It was just like, we've been in Broadway houses, and it was even bigger than that. And they had, the show had been dark for, I think, about like 2 years. And we were walking through, and they were like, well, do you want to come downstairs and see all the costumes? We're like, what do you mean? They're like, oh, well, all the costumes are stored downstairs. And we walked in, and like, I kid you not, it was like 8 huge dressing rooms just filled with showgirl costumes.
Wow.
And it was extraordinary because you're just like, oh, this is the thing. Like we just walked, it was just feathers and sequins. And, because of the showgirl show, there were like 20 to 30, Bob Mackie costumes and headdresses just lining the walls waiting for a show to come back, And that was one of the best things we got to do is we got to borrow a bunch of those costumes for the season. Which was pretty amazing, just to actually have sort of those like living artifacts, that we could actually use and put on people, and which was also pretty exciting to ultimately get to put it on Gina Davis and have her walk through an underground,
I remember a lot of our research also, like it was trying to excavate this very specific strange hammock in Vegas history, which is like the mob had kind of just left, but it's like pre-Steve Wynn. So it's like, it didn't become the kind of more family-friendly Disneyland that it is now. It was still kind of gritty, and like there were pockets of, like people not doing so well, and it being, it was a lot easier for us because it didn't have such a strong identity. it was really an in-between moment where maybe that kind of like gritty badness was also informative in terms of just like this kind of middle zone that they've been dropped into. Like going to Vegas is not like they've totally made it, but it's not sad. Mm-hmm. It's just a kind of, you know, a place
between.
I want to talk a little bit about the tone of the show, because we've been talking, you know, I mentioned earlier, we talked a little bit about, you know, how the season might seem a little bit darker, but it's still ridiculously funny. The character, you know, the characters are flawed, but, you know, ultimately you love all of them. And I'm just curious how you guys ride that line of, you know, writing a comedy or a dramedy, whatever you want to call it, while also still, you know, having things that really hurt, things that, you know, really punch you in the stomach.
I mean, I think it's just how we tell story. It's sort of how we've always written. I mean, we didn't always write together, but I think it's sort of the thing that we share is that kind of a tone, sort of like telling dramatic stories with a comedic voice. Is sort of, I think, the way we think about it. I think it's something that has just always been in our writing. And I think stories that we're attracted to are sort of, you know, stories that can stand that kind of a tone.
Is there like a smell test for you guys? Like, do you know when you veered too far one way or the other, or is it just whatever feels right?
I mean, sometimes you kind of, you take a swing and you don't fully know till editing and you're like, ooh, those two back to back are, that's a real jarring transition. I mean, for us, it's, I don't know if it's necessarily a smell test so much as kind of like a bullshit meter, like, both when we're getting dramatic and when we're getting funny, we want it to be built from something true. And if we get too far from that, I think that's when we both get a little allergic. If something gets too sentimental, we kind of want a treacle cut. Or if something gets too broad, we want to find a way to, you know,
locate the emotion.
So I think that's our kind of what's real tends to be the thing that brings us back.
Yeah. And I mean, we also have, you know, a great bullshit meter and Genji Kohan, who, you know, is always, I think, also shares that sensibility and, you know, pushes things as far as there as they can go in both directions. So
I want to talk about Ruth and Debbie a little bit, just the sort of evolution of those characters as, you know, we've gone from the first season to now. How much of that, of the journey of each of those characters, do you guys have in your heads from the start versus, you know, you're sort of picking up at each season? Do you know where they're going, or is it kind of, you know, something you're figuring out as you go with the actresses?
I mean, I think with Ruth and Debbie, you know, we definitely have a strong idea when we start the season, but they're very complicated characters and we're constantly like reinvestigating our impulses when it comes to the two of them. I think, and Allie and Betty are so extraordinary. And I think in not wanting to ever sort of repeat beats and make sure we're being honest about this friendship, you know, I think part of, I think we just have it's a pretty high bar, in terms of the storytelling with those characters in particular. I do think that the nice thing that we knew going into the third season was that Vegas would give us this opportunity to sort of have them relate to each other sort of away from the scene of the crime a bit. You know, like there is that, like we were just sort of always joking that Vegas should feel like Ruth and Debbie sort of get to have an affair, you know, like a friendship affair. And that was something we talked about a bunch. And I think when we talked about those scenes, when they're actually together, you know, something we always wondered was like, when are Ruth and Debbie actually going to sort of have a drink, have a meal? What does that look like? You know, the two of them alone together doing a normal thing that I think season one, we're like, that should take a very long time and we should earn that in a pretty profound way. And I feel like going to Vegas and living this totally, you know, separate life from, you know, that feels outside their realities, it sort of gave us these opportunities to excavate parts of that friendship that I think would have been harder to if we had set a third season in LA, frankly.
That makes a lot of sense. Yeah. And, you know, I just wanted something you kind of touched on. It's fun watching the show, because I was, before this interview, I revisited a handful of episodes and I didn't forget, but like the characters, they always feel real, but somehow they surprise me all the, like, consistently in a way that, you know, real people do. And that's not something you see a lot in television or film. I mean, do they still surprise you when you're
talking about them and figuring
out? Yeah. I mean, it is that weird thing where you're like, oh, it is like talking. It's like so lame to say it, but it does feel like talking about friends, you know, like it is that thing where you just, and I think you should still have the ability to be surprised by your own characters. If you're not, then you're kind of done writing them.
I want to just talk a little bit more generally about process. So, you know, we've been talking a lot about this third season. So at the beginning of a season, you know, you have 10 episodes of television to produce. Just start from scratch. Take us through how you guys handle it, how much you figure out outline ahead of time, you know, with getting the room together, all that stuff.
Oh, that's so hard.
You guys are probably now for the new season, yeah. Right?
No, I mean, it's just a kind of the joke about our show is because we're always pushing ourselves to do things new and different and not repeat ourselves. We kind of have to reinvent the wheel every season and every episode. So there's no real secret formula that helps us. That said, I think we have a general process that fits into a calendar year. You know, we tend to start, Liz and I will start talking before even we come back about things that we really want to see happen, things we're excited about, just general impulses. We think the spine of the season might be set pieces that we're dying to see. And then we kind of sit with the writer's room probably for the first 2 to 3 months is just staying wide, talking big picture about, again, like character season shapes, where we think certain events may go, ways to kind of tie certain storylines together, but really staying kind of big picture. And, you know, there are days where like, let's just literally just talk the whole day about Ruth and Debbie. The next day might be a day about themes. We just kind of keep hopping to where we impulsively feel like we're a little weak.
Yeah. We tend to follow our panic.
Yeah.
Like if one of us wakes up, we're just like, okay, so at 3 a.m, like this is the thing I started worrying about. And we usually start the day there.
Yeah. We often start with what kept us up at night. It's true. And then after I'd say 3 months, we start breaking episodes, as a group. And then we don't outline the full season for you, right? We kind of go one at a time. And then send the writer off with an outline once the room has broken that. But there's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of things you learn also once you start production and you have to kind of go back and retrack a little, or something surprises you and you want to plant it into the season. There are times when you've been building to something the whole season and you get there and you're like, well, this emotionally makes no sense now. Let's reinvestigate. Why did we want to go here? Where do the characters actually want to go? And we still get, can this still be a bridge to the ending we want? So
when you're putting your room together, what are the qualities you're looking for in, you know, other writers in the room with you guys?
I mean, I think the first thing is sort of like a tonal cousin to, you know, to sort of what we're doing. We're not looking for sort of like an exact match, but people who, you know, have strong voices, clearly have a comedic sensibility and can really sort of handle story, you know, in a sort of, you know, basic beginning, middle, end kind of a way. I think as a rule, we tend to read, I think just because we met as playwrights. And I think for us, you know, I think we've mostly read original samples of people, just trying to meet them on the page and figure out who they are. But yeah, I think that's part of what we're sort of after.
When you're looking for people who are, you know, nimble, who can be excited and share that excitement, who, you know, can approach the show as something you couldn't bring yourself, which is always the goal. You know, the joke is theoretically you could just write the whole show yourself. it's a, you know, a shit ton of work, but you could do it. So you want your writers to kind of be bringing you perspectives and stories and energy that you wouldn't thought to bring.
Yeah, you just sort of want them to show up at the table. Like you'll as a showrunner, you're going to get tired. You know, it's a big job and it can break very strong people. So I do think like when you have writers who will come in, you know, excited with ideas, you know, with their own overnight thoughts, with things that, you know, that are that sort of help buoy you to continue building, you know, it's like, and simply like a social thing, like people you want to sit with every day.
Yes.
you mentioned before that, you guys, you know, aren't a traditional like writing team or writing partners. Can you talk about how you came to create this show together?
We are paid like one. Yes.
The things you learn. So Carly and I, we met at a many, many years ago, in like what, like 2005? In a play, something like that?
I suppose. I graduated in 05, so.
So 06. At a playwriting group at this little theater in New York called Ars Nova. And so we would, for 2 years, we were, you know, in a group that met twice a month and read plays out loud. And then we both independently went into TV. I went to work on Nurse Jackie. Carly went to work on Weeds. And we were always friends. But then as I started moving up and in the Nurse Jackie room and finally had the ability to actually hire people, Carly was my first call. And then I think once we were in that room together, it was just that thing of feeling really good, looking across the room, working together. So I think that was sort of the thing that kicked off, you know, the desire to try to create something together.
What's your process, since you're not, you know, you haven't had years of experience writing, you know, co-writing stuff. I'm curious what your process is. Do you guys get together? Do you swap scenes? Are you, you know, talking everything out before? How does that work?
So the joke is when, you know, we wrote that pilot and it took us a year to write the pilot. And then there was some more time after we sold it where we had to get the rights. And by the time we'd kind of regrouped and needed to write episode two and we sat down at a computer together, we'd completely forgotten how we wrote that pilot and how we worked together. So it's been an evolving education for us as well. But I think now we've got it pretty much down to a kind of, we divvy up scenes, we go our separate ways, we never actually sit together. We then swap pages, we give the other person full permission to, you know, edit away. I think both of us like each other's writing so much and aren't precious and understand, I know that Liz will make my pages better. She can literally cut any line she wants. And I think that trust is pretty vital, but we're still two very separate brains and we disagree a lot, which is kind of at the core of what I think makes our partnership pretty strong, which is, you know, there's two of us, so you'd think we divide and conquer, but we actually come to most meetings with kind of not only different perspectives, but often in disagreement and kind of in duking it out, we tend to find, I think, the best, you know, creative solution that probably better than where we started.
As far as, you know, show running, because obviously show running is a lot more than just writing. How does that work when there are two showrunners?
It's great. I mean, I highly recommend not doing that job by yourself. That is the thing I feel like we didn't know going in, but I feel like the thing we learned.
I look at other showrunners and I like pity them. I'm like, you must be so lonely. Like it's not so much of the job is not fun. Like so much of the job is it's midnight and you have to talk about, you know, whether to call, you know, Netflix's, you know, like what department at Netflix to call to talk about maybe firing someone. Like these are not fun conversations to be juggling while you're trying to creatively make a show.
Yeah. And I think it is that, like being in the foxhole with somebody is just better, you know, especially if it's somebody that like you like and trust and respect and have fun with, you know, like it's kind of the dream. Because yeah, it's just, it takes up a lot of your time. You're away from your family. You're doing, like the work is never ending. So like looking at a never ending pile of work and across from that pile of work is like another person. You feel slightly less insane.
Slightly.
Yeah.
You mentioned, you know, I want to just talk a little bit how you, each of you got your sort of start as writers. Carly, do you want to just talk about, you know, you were a playwright. You studied writing in college, I assume.
No.
So take us, how did you get your start as a writer?
I have one of those really annoying stories that's kind of not easy to replicate and just sounds like a bunch of, you know, like a shaggy dog stumbling story. But I was in college. I was studying French and linguistics. I was dared to enter a 24-hour playwriting competition with a friend who wanted to be a director because she thought I'd be funny and not know what I'm doing, so something would come of it. And literally within 24 hours, and I think it was my junior year, I was like, this is the greatest activity anyone's ever done. Why didn't people tell me you could write and make things with friends? And have them produced within 24 hours. But it was kind of too late to study theater. I'd kind of missed my opportunity. So I took one playwriting class, like Playwriting 101. And then when I graduated, I Googled Playwright New York to see whether it was a job. Mm-hmm. And I found a theater called Playwrights Horizons, which is actually one of the kind of like premier theaters for new work and new voices. So accidentally I stumbled upon a great place. I applied to become their intern. Once again, I bullshitted my way in, not knowing what I was doing. And then similarly, while I was there, I started getting very excited about all these new voices, these young playwrights. And I kind of went in with the naivete of someone who didn't know the art form very well. Like, I didn't know the canon. I didn't know, like, I'd vaguely heard of Tennessee Williams and Eugene O'Neill, but like really didn't know their plays. But I did know, you know, Sarah Rule and all these other young players that were really inspiring at that time. And so I applied to Juilliard because I just noticed it was one of the only ones you didn't have to take a test to get into. And then I also got into that. Anyway, the story just keeps going. Like, it's like every step of the way is like on a whim. But at the same time that I was going to Juilliard, which was this kind of very serious, intimidating place, I had gotten into this playwriting group at the theater where I met Liz Arzanova, which is one of these magical places that we could spend the entire podcast talking about. But like at its core, it's really, it almost has the soul of like an old vaudeville house that's nurturing young artists of all different kinds, not just playwrights. We were in a building with musicians and, you know, people who were puppeteers
and comedians.
There were just so many different types of artists there, and it was a really like loose, exciting place to be yourself and try to figure out your voice. So that kind of in contrast with, you know, I think Juilliard was the place I kind of tried to fake it to make it, and Ars Nova was the place where I really got to both be myself and meet other people who were trying to do the same thing, which is, I think it makes sense that that's where I met Liz. And then, yes, we went on to more grown-up things where we also saw that our grown-up brains and professional lives could work together. You know, by the time we had gotten to Nurse Jackie, Liz had a kid and we had, you know, I'd worked on Weeds. We had kind of grown up a little, but, and then the step to TV was equally stumbling, where just I had a play at the Humana Festival of New Plays, and a fellow playwright, Roland Jones, who was someone I really admired, came to my play. And he loved it and said he was working on Weeds and could he pass my play to Jenji Kohan. And I
worked out great.
So Roland Jones is really the answer to the whole. Liz and I try to emulate that. I mean, to be the people who kind of, everybody needs help. So try to, you know, champion who we can. And
I'm sure they appreciate it. I hope they do anyway. Liz, can you talk about your journey a little bit? Was it as Carly's?
I mean, parts of it, I guess. I did go to school. I went to undergrad for playwriting. I went to NYU. I was like a theater and choir nerd in high school, but then figured out I didn't want to actually perform. I needed more control. So I decided to try writing. And, you know, spent 4 years in New York seeing every play I could and, you know, trying to finish as many plays as I could, which was hard. And then, you know, graduated with no money and found a job working actually in publishing for 6 years. I was a beauty editor by day and a playwright by night. Oh, wow. So I wrote, you know, copy about shampoo and mascara and lip gloss. And it was actually a pretty perfect day job for me because, you know, it was a bunch of I have, you know, like great friends from that time and actually got to spend my day, you know, at least writing something. And then I also had an office I could use when everybody went home to try to finish my play. But it was kind of a slog for a little while because I didn't have I write plays pretty slowly, and I didn't have sort of that one play, and I kept trying to like crack this one play as opposed to writing a bunch of plays. And then I finally did. And when I went to Ars Nova for this playwriting group, they decided they wanted to produce it. And then it ended up sort of having a larger life and being a co-production with a bigger theater. And then it got some like nice attention and some, you know, like some awards attention. And then my agents who I had were like, well, have you ever thought about TV? And I was like, well, I haven't, but I also know that like, I don't know any playwrights that support themselves by just being playwrights. There are other, you know, teaching or writing TV, or they have a trust fund. So I think I read every single pilot that was going to, every single pilot that was shooting that year. I just, you know, they have a database that they'll send you. They're like, just check this out and see. And I read every single thing. And I think I came back to them and said, I would like to try to get a meeting on Mad Men or the untitled Edie Falco project. And they were like, well, we represent one of the women who created the untitled Edie Falco project. Why don't we send that to her? So they sent my play along. And I think this is actually a more common thing among playwrights, where if you are a staff writer on a show, you're usually the last one hired a lot of the time. Like people will sort of hire in order of seniority a little bit. I think also to make sure they have enough money to hire their sort of big guns. So I remember I got a call to meet with Linda Wall and Liz Rixius, who created Nurse Jackie, and I was in New York and, you know, broke. So they were like, can you fly to LA and meet with these showrunners? And I remember calling my parents, and I was just like, should I just buy a ticket and go fly out there for this meeting? And they were like, yes. So I just like, I was 27. And I still was like, I need permission from somebody to do this crazy thing. And then I did, and I met with them, I think like on a Wednesday. I got the job on a Friday, and I started that Monday and was, you know, came out to LA. They wrote for the first two seasons in LA. So I was, you know, driving a Yaris or something. I think that's what it's called, with like manual windows, and like panicking every time I had to merge. But it was great. It was like the perfect first job that ended up being a job I had for seven seasons, because it was not a traditional room. And I didn't know that. It was like, it was majority female. It was half queer. Half of the writers in the room hadn't written for TV before. It was a really idiosyncratic group of just amazing brains and hearts. And then we were creating the show together, and also getting to see a first season and how heavy that lift is for everybody was also invaluable. And there was just stuff like, I didn't know at the time, it just, you know, great, but just the amount of sort of open conversations about what it could be, and the sort of ability to have these like very, very intense, realistic sort of ER stories, and this sort of magical realism, and all these like strains of sort of poetic Catholicism through the show. It was just, I just found the right first home, and that was so lucky. And then it shot in New York, so I got to go home and be on set a lot. And so even as a staff writer, I feel like I was afforded and took the opportunity to just be around. Like, you know, I didn't have kids at the time. So I remember I was just like, oh, well, I'm done with the work I have to do. I'm just gonna fucking hang out on set and watch everybody do what they do. And I just learned so much more. I was so much better at writing that show because I just had so much access to what was happening early on. And then, I stayed on that show from the beginning to the end, which is also an incredible gift.
Can you talk a little bit more about that, being able to actually see an entire show through from beginning to end? But also, it must be weird because you weren't the creator of the show. So you're almost like, you're along for the ride, but.
Yeah. I mean, it was like, it was also, cause the creators actually stepped away from the show, in the fourth season, after the fourth season, to return to their families in LA. And then, the show, switched hands, and that was also an intense experience to be sort of with the creators and then have, you know, a sort of new regime come in. But also an incredible learning experience, because I think I got to sort of step into a much bigger role. And, you know, that was when, if I hadn't stuck around, besides the fact that I wouldn't have gotten to see those characters all the way through, I think trying to figure out how to hire a room before having to really do it for my own show was great for me. You know, just thinking about sort of like, what does the show need? What was great that we had? What do we need going forward? You know? So it was nice to have a voice in that way. Cause I mean, as much as it wasn't my show, I cared about it. And felt such a responsibility to, what Liz and Linda had created, and felt frankly, a lot of responsibility to Edie, and that character. So I think trying to figure out how to land a show, the answer I think is, if it's good, I think the answer is, a lot of the answers are in that pilot. You know, it's sort of like, what were the sort of foundational questions? What were sort of the founding sins of the characters? You know, I think it was, I think as much as shows evolve, you look at the beginning to figure out the end. And I think the other thing I remember is just how many times we all had to push to just sort of reinvestigate what we wanted that ending to be. And I mean, I remember Carly was with me for a lot of that, because I did the story for that final episode. And it took a ton of brain power. But I do remember really vividly, like, going back and rereading the pilot episode of that show a lot, as we were building that final season.
Is that something you guys do when you're getting ready for a new season of GlOW? Do you go back and look at stuff you from previous seasons? Carly's shaking her head now.
Well, we had never done it. You know, we are writing our final season currently. So this was the kind of first time we did it. And we both started watching the first season and were so surprised. I mean, not surprised by how much we love it, but how much I personally had kind of even forgotten certain moments or scenes, or it was both very informative and just like it's a nice feeling to like your show enough that when you go back, you enjoy watching it as a viewer, and you can kind of lose some of the, you know, behind the scenes mechanics that we're always trying to look forwards, and we, you know, by the time you finish a season, editing it, sound mixing it, color correcting it, you know, you've seen each episode 1,200 times. So it really does kind of sink into your bones in a way that's very helpful for building the show forward, but in a way that you kind of have it in you so deeply that you don't need to really rewatch at least the season before.
Yeah. But it was nice to go all the way back.
Has it been bittersweet writing the final season?
Yeah, I mean, it was definitely bittersweet. I mean, I'm the crier of the two of us, and I think every time we pitched out the final season to people, like we always pitch out to Netflix, and I cried through a large portion of my pitching.
I just let Liz keep going because I knew it was more effective.
But yeah, I think it's one of those things where you know, right now we're just in the muck of writing it. So I feel not emotional at all. I just feel buried. But no, I think it's sort of, it's a surreal thing, just to be able to, honestly, just like to know that we're going to get to finish the story we started. Like, that in and of itself is a real privilege.
It's so difficult to land this many planes that I think what kind of helps is the sheer amount of work, the tsunami of work at all times is
it fights any sentimentality.
It's like you can cry when it's over, but we have so much work to do until then. And also obviously just this COVID quarantine we're in has really also kind of changed the process and the tenor of what it's like to work on a final season, really kind of both stretching it out, so we're kind of living in it a lot longer than maybe we would have
So how are you guys dealing with that? Is there a virtual writer's room? Obviously, productions, if it started, it stopped. And if it hasn't started, we don't know when it will.
It started. We were shooting our second episode when we went down. So
the room kept going virtually for a bit. And, you know, there's thank goodness it's one of the only parts of the process that you actually can do over Zoom, since it is a bunch of people just hanging out and talking. It's a little harder without both having the kind of physical world of the show near you. Like Liz and I do a lot of, if we're stuck or we hit a wall, we'll take a walk around the sets, both for inspiration and just to kind of remember the world. And then, you know, the happy accident of bumping into an actor, having a conversation that sends your brain somewhere. It's a bummer to not have that, but we know we shall again. But, you know, childcare is really the headline here, where, you know, Liz is now basically what grade teacher are you now?
I'm both a kindergarten and a fourth grade teacher.
And I'm a, yeah, I don't know, preschool babysitter for half the day. You know, we're bouncing with our husbands and our writers as well. So it's not kind of the, you know, in a dream world, you get kind of intense hours of focus to really dig through. If you hit a wall in a story, take a walk, come back, like spend another hour or two trying to find your way through it. And you kind of don't have that luxury right now. But luckily we had a good half of the season kind of outlined before this happened. So,
yeah. And I think Zoom has been effective, but I think in that weird being on screens kind of a way, like it really, like it's kind of 4 hours before people start to turn into like zombie people, you know, if you're just on a screen talking.
It also is like just funnily at odds with like the 80s vibe of the show. Not saying that our writer's room is a time capsule at all, the 1980 now seven, but there's something about the technology too that's just kind of like a, you know, you got to ignore it to remember that people have no cell phones on our show and no computers. And
yeah.
As we're wrapping up, you've been forewarned of this question. I'm just curious, is there a lessons that each of you has learned along the way that you wish you could go back and, you know, tell your young writer self starting out?
I'm trying to think. I mean, I think that I wasn't like a big joiner. I think being like a moody, artsy kid, I was like, I'm alone and I'll be alone writing and then I'll just be alone. but I think that, and I remember like, even just joining that writer's group, I remember always feeling like intimidated to share, intimidated to be part of a group. And I feel like every time I chose to be in a community of particularly writers, it made my writing better. It made my work better. It's the thing I like about TV, that you're not alone with it forever. I think every writer on some level like wants to solve it themselves and wants to have the perfect thing that just, you know, sprang out of their head. And I think the older I get, the more I want to solve it with other people. And that's sort of the fun and the beauty of it. So I think sort of like the sooner you let yourself off the hook, like, and you don't have to be a singular genius. You just have to find people you want to create things with and find your community of people and like hold on to them and keep going. Find the people who make your writing better.
That's very good advice. Carly, what about you?
It's funny, this is going to sound like my producer brain is getting stronger than my creative brain, but I think reminding oneself that like, this is not just a piece of writing. You're handing this to people, asking 200 people to come live in a world with you, to care about it, to make it, to pay for it. So you should really care about what you're writing. You should care enough about it that you want people in it with you, that you're going to ask other people to give up their time, their creative energy, and to put their passion into this thing. Which is not to say you can't write, you know, a goofy whim on a weekend and in 48 hours have a really funny comedy script that then will go on to win Emmys. But I think realizing what a pilot is, which is, you know, it's a blueprint for a whole world and it's a calling card for your voice and for what you care about. Like it's more important than you think. It shouldn't freak you out. It shouldn't freeze you up so you don't write. But, you know, I think it's a good reminder to force you to be ambitious and to realize that it's, you know, it's not just like a 30-page exercise.
I think that's really good advice. I hope people listen. Thank you guys so much for your time.
Of course.
Good luck with the fourth season. Can't wait to see it. Take care.
Thanks to Liz Flahive and Carly Mensch for coming on the show. GlOW is streaming on Netflix right now. This episode was produced by Kayla Guess. Editing and post-production done by Sadie Dean. Music is by Santiago Arias. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, write on.